This is Kyle Kyle, and welcome to another episode of WHEELZ of Fury. And I just realized it yesterday, editing a while ago, and we're at, I think, 51 or 52.
I'd say probably like 52.
Yeah, so.
Because after the new year, we basically started doing these videos on, like, every week.
Yes.
And usually we do a video and then, like, take a break for a week or two and then do another video and then do another video and take a break for a week or two or whatever. Or maybe do a video one week and then the next week just hang out and not do a video. And then a week after we do another video. It's either, like, do a video and take 2 weeks off or, like, every other week we do a video.
Yeah, we usually do a video. I post it midnight Monday. Unless it's a pay-per-view, then it'll go up on Saturday. So, yeah, that's the secret, I guess. This was a good, you know, week in WWE. Monday Night Raw was good.
Yeah.
Fairly. Just found out that Jason Jordan is actually injured.
Yeah, like, big time injured.
I thought, yeah, and usually you think it's a part of the storyline, but in this case, it kind of isn't.
Well, yeah, I mean, when they had the tag match in the Royal Rumble, and, you know, Cesaro pushed Jason Jordan into the ring post, it's like, okay, yes, he's hurt, and he's gonna be still hurting, but he'll be able to, you know, still compete and whatever. And then it comes out that he's, like, legitimately hurt.
Yeah.
And he might need surgery, and he could potentially be out of action for, like, a year or more.
Yeah.
So, like, yeah. The thing I read, I don't really know the extent of the injury, but it's to the point where it might require surgery, and if it does require surgery, he could be able, like, 12 to 14 months, which is, yeah.
Yeah, it's like with James Ellsworth, now he's rag on him, but in actuality, yeah, Jason Jordan is a really good wrestler. I think that they gave him a shitty gimmick. But, you know, that is what it is.
I mean, when he was in NXT and on Raw and he was partnered with Chad Gable, you know, they played off each other really well to
SmackDown?
Yeah.
Foul!
They played off each other really well and they worked together. It was two kind of amateur wrestlers, one as, like, in the Olympics, the other one was, like, collegiate level and whatever. And then when they moved Jason Jordan over to Raw from SmackDown, at first the whole Kurt Angle-Jason Jordan story was interesting, but then at some point it got annoying.
Yeah.
And then they decided to make Jason Jordan this annoying crybaby whiner.
The thing is, it didn't make any sense to me.
Yeah.
I understood where they were going from.
Right.
But at the same time, it's like, okay, so why don't we introduce Jason Jordan's mother? You know, we did that with Shelton Benjamin, but that was a different circumstance.
Yeah.
Introduce a black woman, whatever, to the WWE and on Raw. And they can, I don't know, fight it out, who knows. But it is what it is, and yeah, you know, hopefully Jason Jordan will have a speedy recovery, I guess.
Yeah.
But what happened in the beginning of Raw?
Well, in the beginning of Raw, there was a match with Roman Reigns and Bray Wyatt. It was a qualifier match for the chamber. And Roman ended up winning. So now it's Braun Strowman, John Cena, Elias Sampson, Roman Reigns, and Elimination Chamber. And, well, it was going to be a match with Finn Balor against, I believe it was Scott Dawson. But when the Revival came out, they were like, hey, Finn, why don't you choose one of your two buddies and we'll have a tag match and we'll show you how it's done. So it ended up being the Revival against Finn Balor and Carl Anderson.
Yeah, I don't know where they're going with this storyline.
I don't know either.
I don't know. I'm hoping that it isn't a cheap way to bury the Revival because reasons.
Well, you know, I thought about this. It was like, when the Revival first debuted on NXT, they blew through the tag team division like nothing. They're two-time NXT tag team champions. They made it to the main roster. They ended up on Raw. They were carrying the momentum they had from NXT on to Raw. And then one of them gets injured, so the other one kind of carried on solo for a little bit. Yeah. And then when they was healed, they're a team again. But then the other one got injured, took some time off, got healed. And now that they're back together, it's like they're trying to reestablish themselves as a formidable tag team.
Yeah.
And kind of try to pick up where they left off before both got injured.
Yeah.
Because it seemed like after they both got injured and had some time off and got back together as a tag team and started wrestling tag team matches again, they haven't really lost the chemistry together. It just seems their momentum stalled.
Yeah. Well, hopefully they can get back to where they need to be.
Yeah.
Be nice to see them as the Raw Tag Team Champions, but who knows what the hell is going to happen.
And it's not even like they really lost momentum either, it just stalled out.
Right.
When they both got injured.
So, that was interesting. Mickey James and Sonya, for some reason, thought about Sonya Blade.
Yeah.
Sonya Deville had a match. And Mickey James won. It wasn't without a beatdown from Absolution.
Yes.
And who should make the save? Alexa Bliss.
Yeah.
Now, with me, I'm thinking to myself, oh, an Alexa Bliss face turn. And then I hear from a bunch of, well, a few people, including yourself.
Yes.
So that's not the case, which kind of makes sense once you think about it.
It could very well end up being a face turn for Alexa Bliss. When I say this to Matt, it's my thoughts of it. It could eventually lead to a face turn, potentially, but you've got Alexa Bliss, Mickie James, Bayley, Sasha Banks, Sonya Deville, and Mandy Rose, all in the Women's Elimination Chamber match. So it's like, okay, Mandy Rose and Sonya Deville are members of Absolution. They're going to have each other's back. They're probably going to work together inside the chamber. Yeah. Bayley and Sasha Banks, okay, yes, they're fought each other. Yes, they've had matches against each other. Yes, they kind of argue with each other about who they think is the one that's deserving of a championship, although right now it's kind of like, who's going to be the one to end Asuka's undefeated streak? But anyways, we'll digress from that. So Bayley and Sasha Banks are like best friends, so they're more than likely going to have each other's back inside the Elimination Chamber and probably work together as well. And, you know, Mickie James is going to for sure try to capture the Women's Championship for an eighth time.
Right.
So that kind of leaves Alexa Bliss as the odd one out. So my thoughts were, if Alexa can somehow convince Mickie to work cohesively with her inside the Elimination Chamber, that way it won't be a 5-on-1 beatdown, so to speak.
Yeah.
And, you know, possibly have, like, Mickie James and Alexa work together and maybe try to eliminate Bayley and then Sasha Banks and then the two members of Absolution, and maybe in the end have a 1-on-1 at the end for the championship. Now, we'll see what progresses as we get closer to Elimination Chamber, but for right now, it's like Alexa is trying to regain her friendship with Mickie James.
Yeah.
So.
Well, see, and I took it as, okay, she's asking, are you okay? Are you okay? And I expected the throwing on the barricade or whatever. Yeah.
Throw her face down on the stage, yeah. And throw her into the LED boards or something.
But that didn't happen, so it almost seems like she's trying to suck up to Mickie James.
More or less, yeah.
See, okay, you're not gonna take the belt from me. If that's the case, who knows? I think, yeah, you know what? Mickie James does need, or should have, anyways, another title run.
Yeah.
And why the fuck not? Because she is a legend in the wrestling business.
Yes.
You go back to Ring of Honor, which I had no idea about. Then she goes on to TNA after her WWE run, so it makes a lot of sense just to have her have another title run.
Well, it was interesting because she was originally in DNA. Her name was Alexis Bordeaux, I believe.
Oh. Foul!
She was with CM Punk and Chris Steele, I think was the other guy's name or whatever. Or was it Raven, not CM Punk?
Yes, I think it was Raven.
Yeah, it was Raven. And then I don't know how long she was there, maybe a year or whatever. And then she went to WWE, had 5 years, I think, or whatever, in WWE. Jumped back to TNA, had an extensive run in TNA, became like 4 or 5-time Knockouts champion. Goes to NXT and has a match with Asuka, and then ends up on Monday Night Raw, and
SmackDown, and then Raw. Well, anyways, the rest is history.
Yeah.
So, see where it goes from here, you know. So, yeah. Well, so the thing with Jason Jordan, and he was supposed to have a rematch with the Bar.
Yeah.
And he can't wrestle. He gets backstage. And so Kurt Angle's like, well, you gotta forfeit. And Seth is like, well, maybe I'll find a tag team partner. So, how convenient. Here comes Roman Reigns.
Yeah. Roman Reigns just happens to overhear whatever, and it's like, well, the Lex Leg is gonna be two of the three members of the Shield going for the tag titles, and two of the members of the Shield that were tag team champions when Dean had the US title.
And you know, it's funny because of all the Shield members,
all three of them have been United States champion. All three of them have been World Heavyweight champion.
Yeah.
And you can pretty much say all three of them have been tag champions because when the Shield got back together,
yeah,
Dean Ambrose and Seth Rollins won the tag titles from Sheamus and Cesaro. And then, like I said, previously when the Shield was together, it was Seth Rollins and Roman Reigns as the tag champions.
Yeah, I was gathering my thoughts here for a second. Well, it's Dean Ambrose and Roman Reigns who are the Grand Slam champions.
Yeah, pretty much.
Because Seth Rollins hasn't really had that feud for the Intercontinental title.
No.
But he is, you know, former Universal, former WWE, former
Tag Team,
former
US Champion.
Yeah, so the Intercontinental title is basically the only one he hasn't had. And that's what they were talking about, too. It's going to be either Finn Balor and The Miz, or Seth Rollins and The Miz, feuding for the Intercontinental title, so hopefully one of them will get the Intercontinental title.
Yeah.
But, yeah. So, what else happened on Monday Night Raw?
Well, there was the three-way for who would enter the Elimination Chamber last.
Oh, yeah.
And Elias ended up winning.
That's right. Which is weird, because he just came in from NXT, and he hasn't really done too much. I mean, he did have a few encounters with John Cena, but...
Yeah,
it's kind of surprising that they're going to actually give him that opportunity right away. When I think that he should go for the Intercontinental title or whatever. But that's where they want to put him, whatever. I mean, look what they did for Bray Wyatt. He hadn't really done that much.
Yes.
So, yeah, so that was a fucked up feud. But, anyways, yeah, so Elias wins, then you get the Braun Strowman beatdown
here,
which I figured, you know, and that's kind of fucking dumb, because here is an opportunity for you motherfuckers to put Braun Strowman in the fucking Elimination Chamber, and you don't do that, you go with Elias, who hasn't done that much. Roman Reigns has gone through everybody, left, right, and center. He's done violent shit to Brock Lesnar, the man that nobody can fucking touch. And you're not going to give him a title opportunity. I mean, sure, he's been in title matches, but he hasn't really done that much. He hasn't really been given the fucking title. So, hopefully by Elimination Chamber, maybe not. If you're not going to put the belt on him at WrestleMania, then he might as well go somewhere else.
Yeah.
The man deserves to be Universal Champion. Now, there's no debate about that. But you assholes, don't have to do anything. Listen to the fucking crowd. But no, we gotta go with the popular guys, and it's them that are gonna make our company great. No. It's the guys your company, your fans are cheering for. You should be listening to them, but no, we can't do that. So, same song and dance. I wish Braun Strowman go to SmackDown. But, you know what? We'll see what happens come after Elimination Chamber, because there has to be some kind of push for him. It was The Miz versus, actually, Apollo Crews. And I'm really enjoying the Titus Worldwide brand, especially, or Team Oreo, as I want to call them now.
Yeah.
Because Dana Brooke does actually fit in. I think that's cool. And so, I don't know where they're going to go with that either, but I'm hoping that something happens soon, because Titus O'Neil's been in the WWE now for at least 5 years, and I really don't know what they're going to do with Dana Brooke, but where they are right now is pretty cool.
Yeah.
But yeah, he lost against The Miz. Motherfucker. Yeah. Well, I mean, Raw should be interesting Monday. I don't know what they're going to do with Braun Strowman, or, I mean, Jason Jordan's gone, so it's just back to basically Seth and Roman, so
yeah.
We'll just see what happens on Monday, I guess. Who knows?
Pretty much.
Yeah. So SmackDown was a good show, though.
Yeah.
And once again, I missed half of it
yeah.
in the beginning, so I'm not sure exactly what happened. I wish I would have read up on it, but...
Now, SmackDown started with Jinder Mahal in the ring, and he's talking about having the match with Sammy and Kevin, and how he's been looking forward to having them rip each other apart, but he doesn't understand why they're getting another WWE Championship opportunity, and he calls out Daniel Bryan, and he's talking to Daniel, and he's saying, like, I don't understand your judgment. I don't think this is the right call. I don't think this is a good idea. And Daniel's like, well, this is a little bit, you know, we're the land of opportunity, and we're giving these guys an opportunity. And, you know, they're going back and forth talking. And at one point, Shane goes, I have a feeling I know why you're kind of friendly, chummy, buddy-buddy with Sammy and Kevin, and that's because you're retired, so you're basically living vicariously through them, and that basically rubbed Daniel the wrong way, but out comes AJ, and he's like, you know, since January, I've been defending the championship all over the world, and I've been enjoying my run, and being champions great. I can put up with all the obstacles you put in front of me. And then he goes, what I can't stand is management trying to hold me down. And he's going on about Shane and Daniel and all this other stuff. And it's like, you know, he's not wrong.
No, and that's the thing. It's like we said before, it's childish bullshit. We got one guy who's supposed to be the general manager. The other guy's supposed to be the fucking commissioner, and they're not working together.
Yeah.
So when does it fucking end? You know, you got the AJ Styles. Your WWE champion. Your leader of SmackDown, basically, because he is the champion, and that's what you should focus on. But they're going, oh, well, you know, we gotta fight because that's what we do, and you know, Daniel Bryan is trying to make things better by having wrestlers go, hey, let's pick the top five favorite matches or whatever you want. And, you know, Shane McMahon is now talking shit about the indies. It's like, you fucking idiots, you know, do your job. And that's fucking simple. And you're screwing around AJ Styles, a guy who is your champion. You know, just grow up. I mean, the product is it sucks. It's worse than Stephanie McMahon and Mick Foley.
Yeah. And even Shane had the point of, like, you know, why not have other people have an opportunity for the WWE Championship, like a Baron Corbin, like a Bobby Roode, like maybe a Rusev, or whoever else. And it's like, instead, you're continually having Sammy and Kevin challenge for the WWE Championship. It's basically like nobody else worthy contender for the championship.
Yeah, that's what it seemed like years ago when you had John Cena as the champion, and it went to Randy Orton. And went back to John Cena, then I went to Triple H. It's like, are they the only wrestlers that are worthy of the WWE title? And then you put it on guys like Rey Mysterio, who didn't have it for too long, because we gotta have John Cena come back and win the belt on Raw. It was really fucking bullshit. So now, we're gonna find out what happens comes WrestleMania. Because Shinsuke Nakamura is the Royal Rumble winner. That's a fact. Are you gonna screw him over now? Once he becomes the champion, he's your only real answer you got right now.
Well, it's actually kind of funny, because after AJ said his piece, he basically ended it with, like, I don't care who wins between Sammy and Kevin, one way or another, I'm leaving with the WWE Championship. And then you see AJ walking backstage, and Nakamura comes up to him and he goes, I'm going to beat you at WrestleMania. And it's like, it's not enough that friggin' AJ's got Kevin Owens and Sami's ain't on his mind and who he's gonna face for the championship next between the two of them. And there's that extra pressure, I guess you could say, of like, if I am able to retain my championship, I got Nakamura next.
Man, I love his facial expressions.
Yeah.
I'm gonna beat you at WrestleMania. Or whatever, I'm not good at that.
And you know, even though Nakamura's English is limited, let's say, he's been able to convey feeling through facial expressions.
Yeah.
Which is pretty good.
Yeah. No, I really enjoy his work. And, you know, even his stuff in Japan. Like, they showed this week the match with Nakamura and AJ Styles. And I mean, they have had numerous matches in Japan.
Yeah.
But just the way they work off each other is great.
Oh, yeah.
But there was a match between Liv Morgan and Charlotte.
Yes.
Which I missed, but I believe Charlotte won.
Yes.
So, yeah.
And you know, like I said last week when we did a video, it was either going to be Charlotte's going to start with one of the other two and save Ruby for last, or start with Ruby and then deal with the other two. So, this week she had a match with Liv Morgan. Probably next week will be Sarah Logan, and then maybe the week after will be Ruby.
Well, yeah, I mean, I would save Ruby Riot for Elimination Chamber.
Yeah.
But, like, she's the champion, so I don't know what they're going to do with her. And it's Fastlane, not.
Yes.
So, have a match at Fastlane. Let's see. Yeah, Ruby Riot and Charlotte for the SmackDown Women's title. I mean, it's too soon for Ruby Riot to win the belt, but.
Yeah. Yeah.
You know, they go through both members of the Riot Squad. Let's go and throw Ruby Riot and Charlotte in Fastlane.
Yeah.
Or do what you always do, and have them have a non-title match just so they can go and have a title match in Fastlane. Doesn't make much sense, but was, you know, that would be a pretty good idea.
Yeah.
But the whole gist of this was Sami Zayn versus Kevin Owens for the main event.
The Bludgeon Brothers had a match, and after the match, the Usos came out, and there was a kind of a interaction between the Bludgeon Brothers and the Usos. But after the match, the Bludgeon Brothers are standing kind of at like the bottom of the ramp, and the Usos kind of just walk by them and don't really pay a whole lot of attention to them and get in the ring, and then the Bludgeon Brothers pick up their hammers and start making their way to the back, and of course the Bludgeon Brothers violated and obliterated and dominated and humiliated and eviscerated and demolished another who's who tag team of nobodies. And then, of course, the Usos cut another promo on street etiquette or something like that. And then there was a tag team match with Shelton Benjamin and Chad Gable against, I I think it was the Ascension.
Oh, yeah, it was, yeah. And I missed it, but I think that was the match.
And, yeah, Gable and Benjamin pretty much made short work of the match. And, you know, Chad Gable and Shelton Benjamin sort of remind me of Gable and Jordan. Gable and Benjamin are, I'd say, probably a little more refined than Gable and Jordan. I just, for the love of me, don't buy Benjamin and Gable as heels. It just doesn't work.
No.
It's cheesy, it's corny, it's, they're not intimidating, they're not scary, they're not anything that would remotely make you look at them and go, oh, those guys are a great heel tag team. It's, they're just, and as good as they are in the ring together, and as good of wrestlers as they are, and as well as they mesh together and work cohesively, there's just nothing there that makes them stand out as a viable heel tag team. I mean, fuck. I buy Cesaro and Sheamus better as a heel tag team than Gable and Benjamin. It just doesn't work.
And you look at a team like Ascension, who, oh my god, are you serious? They come in from NXT, they're badasses, they got the black and the gothic makeup, you know. In fact, you got them in NXT with Bram, and Bram left, and then you got the Victor comes in. So these guys, you know, they make their way to WWE. Yeah, they had a stupid gimmick trying to, you know, name all these legends, you know, whatever. And then they actually did become a good tag team.
Yeah.
And now all of a sudden they're thrown in the Fashion Files and they become pussified. And I don't even know, did they wear fucking makeup this week?
Oh, yeah.
Oh.
Like, with Victor, he's got like the two-faced look, if you will. Like, half his face painted, the other half of his face ended. Is it?
Yeah.
With Connor, it's like stitches on his lips type thing.
And then they lose to Benjamin. And you see, that's how you fuck up the most intimidating take team that you have. Like, what the hell did they do to deserve that treatment?
Yeah. You take them from being one of the most badass tag teams in the WWE and make them a comedy act.
Yeah, it just doesn't work out. It's fucking bullshit.
Yeah.
You want to talk about roles that don't really make sense. Having Miz as the face was terrible. Although, watching Raw Flashback, and you had that excitement on Miz Talk with him and Michael Stratton and Titus O'Neil, that worked out well. But other than that, Miz was a shitty face.
Yeah, with Miz as a face, he didn't really have too many people to work off of.
No.
Well, Miz as a heel, he could work off of anybody.
Oh, yeah. So, I mean, there's the disappointing match with Sammy and Kevin. It's like, it ended in disqualification.
Yeah.
So really nothing to fucking talk about. Thanks, guys. We move on to 205. And really, it kind of was a short show.
Fairly short show.
I mean, we had
Derek Maverick.
And he was still talking about the show.
Yeah.
In the tournament and all this other stuff.
Yeah.
The matches you already have. Kalisto took on Gran Metalik, which, you know, it was what you or what you would think. It was a very good match. You had two luchadores working off each other. A pretty good bumps.
Yeah.
Yeah, you might say. But Kalisto actually ended up getting the win.
Yes.
So that was cool. And then you had Roderick Strong make his 205 debut. Is he actually going to be a member of 205 now, or did he just have a match with Kenta Kobashi?
Well, here's the interesting thing, because they had Roderick Strong against Kenta or Hideo Itami. This is for the Cruiserweight tournament, and Roderick ended up winning, which means he advances. However, next week on NXT, it's going to be Roderick against Pete Dunne for the United Kingdom Championship.
Oh, jeez.
So, here's my thoughts. It'll play out like this. Next week, they'll have the match with Roderick Strong and Pete Dunne. Have Pete Dunne go over on Roderick Strong, continue Roderick Strong on in the 205 Cruiserweight tournament, and just see how far he goes.
Yeah. I think I'm putting him in a lot of good matches. And this was a good match, too. I mean, like I said, Hideo Itami is a very good wrestler. All the Japanese, well, I've said this all before, but this was a good match, and
you want to talk about two dudes that lay of India, holy hell.
And they're legends in their own mind, because you got Roderick Strong, who came from Ring of Honor. He goes to NXT. He does very good there. He has a match now with Hideo Itami, who was in New Japan, who's been, I'm sure he's the champion there as well. And, you know, he's great with the kicks and, you know, also really hard hitting.
Yeah.
And so this match was amazing. And yeah, it was unfortunately a short show. I can't think of any other match that was on.
There wasn't any other match. It was those two.
It was cool though. I really enjoyed it. And next week, hopefully it'll be a little bit more constructive, I guess. Unless they're trying to just build in for their tournament for WrestleMania.
Possibly.
But you see, what I heard, and it was just a rumor, so there's a possibility that 205 will be extinct after WrestleMania.
Yeah.
There really isn't that much going on. Like, you have NXT, you have tag team division. They got a tag team championship. SmackDown has a tag team championship. Raw has a tag team championship. 205 really doesn't have that. They just have the Cruiserweight championship. It would make a lot of sense. And I don't know what, I mean, they had a good concept. But have a few of your guys go to Raw, and a few of your guys go to SmackDown, and that's it. You keep the Cruiserweight title, but you get rid of the show altogether, because you have these guys also have matches on Raw, which doesn't make sense to me. Keep them on 205. So yeah, deleting 205 altogether is not a bad thing. It makes a lot of sense. You can go back to having guys, and you know what? It'll be a bigger roster. It just, that's the way I look at it.
When you have a group of guys are solely part of one division, and you have one championship specifically for that division, if you introduce other championships, it'll just dilute it.
Yeah, I know.
It absolutely will. Now, could you put guys from 205 on Raw and SmackDown? Absolutely. You could for sure have the title on one of the guys. It would just be a matter of, like, do you keep the title on one roster, or do you kind of bounce the title back and forth between both rosters if you split up the 205 division for Raw and SmackDown?
Yeah, that's not occurred to me.
I mean, let's say you do split up the 205 division, but like half on Raw and half on SmackDown. I don't really think there's that many guys on the 205 Live roster to begin with.
Nah, you're right there.
Because you got Jack Gallagher. For sure we'll have Brian Kendrick when he comes back. You got TJP. You got Kalisto. You got Gran Metalik. You got, let's say, Dorado. Yeah. You got
Drew Gulak.
Tony Nese. Rich Swann. Cedric Alexander. Mustafa Ali.
Ari Davari.
Yeah, I
can't think of anybody else.
So that's like, yeah. What, 12 guys?
Yeah, about that.
So, okay, you could go 6-6. Which would work out. And the thing about having some of the cruiserweights on SmackDown would be, how well could you integrate them into SmackDown? Like, with Raw, it's like, okay, they have a couple matches on Raw, whether it be one-on-one or tag match, whatever, and it works. With SmackDown, it'd be a little more difficult, I think.
Yeah, you're right.
And it's like I said, whoever the champion is by the end of this 16-man tournament, if you do decide to part ways with the 205 Live show and either split them up on Raw and SmackDown, or maybe have the whole cruiserweight division go to Raw, could you work with have one guy be cruiserweight champion on Raw for a little bit, and then their cruiserweight division on SmackDown be champion for a little bit? Or, you know, how would you work that? Because, I mean, like, really? You've only got a few shows out of the year that are co-ed shows, you could say?
Yeah.
Like, at both Raw and SmackDown, I'm doing the show. Other than that, it's SmackDown presents you this, Raw presents you this. So, I mean, it kind of be a jumble. Or, like I said, you know, put the 205 Live of the whole roster on Raw and just kind of work with that and maybe integrate them a little bit more and have them have maybe more than just two matches on the show.
Yeah, I mean, the way it worked 15, 14 years ago is you had SmackDown as the high flyers,
yeah,
and the guys who could go a little bit faster, and Raw was basically the brawler show, where you had these big, muscly guys that, well, with the exception of Shawn Michaels,
yeah,
I guess, they didn't really do a lot of high-flying moves and risky moves and all that, so.
Yeah.
So it's like, okay, now it's on to Raw, who presented 205.
Yes.
You have Raw shows like, well, Fastlane's coming up.
Yes.
So it's going to be like a 205 match there. Every pay-per-view is going to have a 205 match.
Right.
And that's fine and good, but it's like, it's too bad that it didn't go the other way. Like I said, SmackDown was great when it had the Cruiserweights. But I know things change. It's just, you know, if 205 should end, and it should, then there has to be, like, either go on Raw or go on SmackDown.
Yeah.
I didn't think about having a Cruiserweight title.
Yeah, exactly.
But, I mean, even if you do that, you still have the guys on Raw or SmackDown, whichever, compete for the U.S. title, with the Intercontinental title, or anything. But there was one segment on the show that really interested me. You had Derek come out, and he had Tony Nese and Drew Gulak, and then they were talking about a match, and Derek goes, you know what? This whole PowerPoint presentation stuff is terrible. And you talking about your abs, that's terrible. That's not what wrestling is all about. You gotta be serious, and you gotta take this job serious. Next week, you're gonna have a match with each other. And it's like, but that's kind of what made it a little bit entertaining. But, I mean, to me, it was more entertaining than half the shit I see. So, then we go on to NXT. NXT was a good show.
Oh, fuck, was it ever.
You got the beginning, and it's a rematch. Supposedly, you had Sanity, and you had Undisputed Era. They come out, and they're brawling, and it just went chaos, and out comes a pissed off William Regal, and he's like, you're gonna have a hardcore match in the main event tonight. And
a six-man tornado style tag match.
Yeah. So, that was a good show. Shayna Baszler, they interviewed her again.
Yeah.
Of course, when she had her don't give a shit attitude.
Yeah.
But.
And they did a little segment to Tyler Bate.
Yes.
Talking about his match against TJP and both his matches and what his thoughts are and what his feelings are about that. And then, you know, talking about him having match of the year on NXT with Pete Dunne and what it feels like to accomplish that. In 2018, he's looking forward to having some more matches a year and working with guys like Aleister Black or Velvet Team Dream or Roderick Strong or any other guy on NXT, and just kind of what his shoes want to be like with NXT. And then, of course, you got Johnny Gargano coming out and talking about his loss to Andrade Cien Almas, and you know how he had his family with him and how close he was to becoming the champion. And then he turns his attention to Muscle Ciampa, and he's like, man, I haven't said a word since TakeOver Chicago, but you know what, to Muscle Ciampa, I'm sick of you, I want a match with you one-on-one, all this other stuff. And then friggin' here comes Almas and Vega, and they're gloating about, oh, you're not Johnny Gargano, you're not Johnny Wrestling, you're a Johnny Loser, beating you three times. And, you know, there's Johnny and Andrade kind of going back and forth with each other. And then Zelina gets up in Johnny's face, and she's pushing him, provoking him. And the fans are chanting, we want Candice, sure enough, here she comes and puts Vega on her ass.
Yeah.
Candice pushes Vega down, and then Andrade and Johnny exchange with each other. And then pissed off Vega on the microphone, what is it going to take to get rid of you? We've beaten you three times. And Johnny goes, well, give me another opportunity at the championship. And it's like, alright, fine, we'll give you another shot at the title, but if you lose, you're out of NXT for good. And Johnny's like, okay, fine, I'll take it.
And you know, it made me think, if he loses this match, let's say, would he go to Raw or SmackDown?
I thought of that too. I don't really think they're gonna have Johnny leave NXT just yet, only because they eventually going to put Gargano and Ciampa in a match with each other.
Yeah. I mean, they have to put the belt on him.
Oh, yeah.
I'm sure they're going to do it, too. just so they may have Johnny and Ciampa.
Yeah.
But Heavy Machinery had a match.
Yes.
With the Italian dudes.
Tino Sabatelli and Riddick Moss.
And it was interesting because, you know, these two guys, like I said, are brick shit houses.
Yeah.
Once again, seeing a heavy set guy do the worm just makes me. It's just awesome.
The Caterpillar.
The Caterpillar. And, of course, Heavy Machinery win. And it was good.
Yeah. You can see during the match there's a bit of dissension between the two of them. Some rather aggressive tags, you could say. And then at the end, when Tino gets beat, he's on the outside. You know, you can tell he's hurt. And he holds out a hand to Moss, and Moss is like, no, I'm out of here. So it's like, well, the Eagle train has left the station.
Yes. And then we get to the main event. And you know, these three individuals always knock it out of the park.
Oh yeah, both Jesus. Groups are amazing, and just the fact that six of them pretty much beat the piss out of each other.
I mean, you had Wolf chase somebody backstage.
Yeah.
And that's like, you rarely get to see something like that in a match.
And yeah, have like four of the guys backstage and then two guys in the ring, and then you see them kind of go up a set of steps and it's like, where does that go? And then go to a wide angle side of the ring, and then in the background and the crowd, you see them come up. It's like, oh, that's where that leads to.
Yeah.
But friggin' have the Great Dane, they're calling him now.
Yeah.
Essentially, when the match is like, okay, if you're gonna pick a standout of that group, that's your guy.
Yeah. I mean, well, it was either gonna be him or Wolf. As much as Young is awesome, I think it's those two. I mean, Wolf is deranged, and then you have, like, the Highlander guy.
Yeah.
Kind of.
Alexander Wolf is deranged. Eric Young is the maniacal leader.
Yeah.
Nikki Cross is the
psycho.
Psychotic Scotch woman.
Yeah.
And Killian Dane is just the vicious brute. Irishman.
Yeah.
And when I saw the interaction between them at the start of the show and then seeing that match, I got looking at Killian Dane and I was like, he's lost weight.
You think so?
Oh yeah.
Wow.
Like, if you look at him, let's say Andre the Giant Royal Battle Royal, and then you look at him now, there's a difference.
Yeah, oh Jesus, that's awesome.
And you know, we hadn't seen him on NXT TV for a little while, and I don't remember if it was like an injury or something, but he's back on TV now, and he looks like he's down probably at least 100 pounds, I'd say. Mm. Like, he's not smaller.
Oh, yeah.
Like, he's still a big, big dude, but he looked like he lost weight.
Now, let's compare him on 205.
Well, fuck, if you can do what Gold does, you can probably fucking get away with it with Killian.
Yeah. But, once again, it was Gold. These tier tag teams can knock it out of the park. And,
yeah.
You know, it's kind of like, okay, what's going to happen if they go to the main roster? Because it would be interesting to see what's going to happen to them. You know, Speaking of which, we still have to have the debut with War Machine. Eventually.
Oh yeah, we're eventually going to have the debut of War Machine. And Ricochet. And then whenever it's going to be with your non-favorite wrestler.
Oh god, yeah. I remember the day that happens.
Yeah.
So, NXT, once again, killed it.
Killed it, as always.
It's going to be explosive February 24th. So, anyways, let's go now to... Did you watch Impact?
Yes.
Well,
let's see. There was another match with Laurel Van Ness and Kira Hogan. This was for the Knockouts Championship. And, of course, Laurel ended up winning. And then there was... this segment with OVE, and it looked like they were video recording Lashley, and it's like, okay, why are you guys doing this? And the next thing you know, they're jumping them, beating them up, like, holy fuck.
And that's what happens.
Throwing them in a trunk of his own car, and it's like, well, I guess now I know the bigger fish they're talking about.
Jeez.
And then there was a tag team match between Cult of Lee and some other tag team. After the match, LAX is talking and they're going like, so OVE jumps us from behind and now you're jumping us from behind and you're wanting a match with us and you're wanting a shot of the tag titles, and you know, there's like three basic things you don't do. You don't tug on Superman's cape, you don't spit in the wind, and you don't piss off LAX. So, that feud is gearing up. And then there was a match with Matt Sydal, Taiji Ishimori, El Hijo de Fantasma, and I can't remember. The interesting thing about it was you have Matt Sydal as the Impact Grand Champion. You've got Taiji Ishimori as the X Division Champion. And then you had El Hijo de Fantasma as the AAA Latin American Champion. So you got three champions in one match. And, of course, Taiji Ishimori and Matt Sydal ended up getting the win. And then there was a four-way match for a number one contender for the Impact Championship. It was Moose, Patron, Impact, and EC3. That was a fairly good match. It was a back and forth match. There was moments of Patron and EC3 working together, and it was, you know, four of them beating up each other at points in the match, and it was overall a good match. And much to the excitement of everybody, you could see Johnny Impact ended up getting the win.
Wow.
Yeah.
Sounds good. Wow. Well, that'd be pretty cool.
Yeah.
Well, we had two Ring of Honor, which was also kind of short. Like, they mentioned Ring of Honor.
Yeah.
And all that other stuff too, but
the Motor City Machine Guns against Trent Beretta and Chucky T, best friends.
Yes.
It was a fairly good match until the Briscoes got involved.
You know, once again, you have so-called censorship taking out everybody, interrupting their matches, Now you're doing that with the Briscoes?
Yeah.
Like, what the fuck? Seriously? So what is...
Yeah, I don't get it either.
I mean, it was a good match.
Yeah.
And then this... Oh. Motherfucker. Like, you know, just... It's anarchy for no...
It doesn't make any sense. You got mayhem happen, anarchy happen, and yeah, you can say, oh, the Briscoes are our heel team, and the Briscoes want to start at the tag titles, maybe have a run with the tag titles. Okay, that's all fine and dandy. But fucking stop interrupting matches, god damn it.
Anyways, I got Marty Squall, the villain, taking on Shane Taylor. And of course, he tried to snap Shane's fingers, which didn't work. He blocked it. Marty won the match. But yeah, it was a close call. I mean, look how big Shane is.
Yeah.
You know, you think he would win. But of course, you know, the villain is a part of the Bullet Club, so.
Yeah.
There it is. Yeah. It's funny because you get these guys who, and it's almost like a Steve Austin effect. They're supposed to be heels, but everybody seems to like them.
Yeah.
So it's kind of interesting that way. So I don't know where they're going. But then we have Cody versus Matt Taven. And we got to see Matt Taven kick Cody in the balls last week.
Yes.
And Cody returned a favor. He comes out, you know, and everyone loves Cody Rhodes. And they're two-sweeting him and kissing his ring and all this other stuff. I still don't like the bleached blonde hair, but whatever. It was a good match, and yes, Cody eventually gave them a seat, did a roll-up pin, and won the match, which is pretty fucking cool.
Yeah.
So that was Ring of Honor. Really nothing special this week.
Not really.
Of course, I just watched Smash.
Yeah.
So, Smash was a good show. A very shocking ending.
Yes. Well, first you had a rivalry continue with the well-oiled machines of Psycho Mike Rollins, yes, and Braxton Sutter against TDT, Mathieu Dubois, and Tomas Saint-Jacques. I don't know why when they say their names, they say them like their regular English names. They're not. They're no. French names. Mathieu and Tomas.
Yeah, oui. Well, I mean, even when they're on the mic, they don't really speak in an accent. To my knowledge, like when I listened to them today, I didn't notice anything, but...
Well, being French-Canadian...
Yeah.
Some people that are French-Canadian have the French accent.
Like Kevin and Sammy.
I guess speak English often enough.
Yeah.
Accent may not be as pronounced.
I know tons of people from Quebec that don't have an accent.
Yeah.
However, so the match went no contest. We have...
Started off with a brawl. Yeah. And, before the match even started... The match started, they're back and forth with each other, they're outside the ring, they're both beating each other up, it's a double count out. Security comes out, separating them, and it's like, well, we want to end this once and for all, so why don't we do it how we usually do it? And the, I guess, co-commentator and matchmaker of Smash Wrestling goes, okay, we're gonna have another match with the four of you, but it's
not gonna be a tables match like everybody wanted. It's gonna be a ladder match, and it's gonna determine who's gonna be the first ever Smash Tag Team Champions, which I never really thought about. They didn't have, so there's another company that doesn't really have a tag team championship. So yeah, it's gonna be TDT versus Well-Oiled Machines for the first ever Smash Tag Team Championship.
Yes.
Then we head to the main event. We have Tyson Dukes putting the title on the line against
the other half of Super Smash Brothers, Stu Grayson.
Yes. And it was a really good match.
Yes.
It was very good. I mean, Tyson Dukes prevailed once again. And, you know, just, they always put on good matches. And he had his Wrestling Factory shirt on. And
yeah.
Just to see him go through Grayson. And, of course, he wins the match. And who should come out? Evil Uno.
Yeah.
So you get Evil Uno come out.
And Super Smash Brothers are beating up on Tyson Dukes. They're getting one up on him pretty good. And then here comes
Frankie TM,
the Beast King.
Yes.
And to make the save, only to turn
heel. Oh boy. You know, it sucks, but at the same time, it makes sense. Because it's just the fact that they're both huge. They're both, like, they were black. They're both that kind of monstrous team. So, yeah, we're getting to see these guys go at it. And, I mean, it sucks, because I really like Frankie TM. I thought he made a good face, but I guess it makes more sense for him to turn heel. But, nonetheless, it is what it is. And we'll see what happens next week.
And they made it come off as the Super Smash Brothers became a heel themselves.
Yeah.
Under the tutelage of the Beast King.
Yeah. So, it sucks. But the way the heel turn was, you know, spraying the mist in the face of Tyson Dukes. And just, you know, the beat down and everything. It's too bad, but we'll see what happens next week. But, you know, this has been a great week in wrestling once again. I really enjoyed this week, and I'm glad that I wrote things down this time and actually remembered, although I haven't watched Impact just yet. It's going to be a good show, nonetheless, and I can't wait to see what happens next week. I mean, you have the Last Real Man and his team of Goliath, like Beer City Bruiser, and what's his face?
Yeah, whatever his name is.
And those two are going to be a great team. You got War Machine eventually coming into NXT, along with Assface and Ricochet, and it's going to be cool. You get Alexa Bliss, who knows if this is just a tactic to get on Mickey James's good side. And then, of course, you get Braun Strowman, who still needs to get a better push than he is getting right now. But anyways, what do you have to say?
I'm looking forward to next week. It should be a good show. They're really building up a lot of things to kind of invest you into Fastlane and Elimination Chamber and other things that will be happening with the other shows. A couple things I found interesting was, one, they made mention of the fact that Tyson Dukes had been Smash Champion for 400 days, which is pretty impressive.
Yes.
And the other was made mention of a pay-per-view Smash is having, or a big event on the 21st of January. I was like, holy shit, this is old.
Oh, yeah. Well, like my brother told me, they're just starting to do the new season of Smash.
Right.
So he's doing a lot more editing and stuff like that. Yeah. So I can't wait to see what happens in the future, or the present, I should say. But, yeah.
One other thing that I had been wanting to do for a little while, but haven't done, so Might as well do it now. Matt and I have both talked about our families. He's talked about his siblings. I've talked about my siblings. I think maybe a few times I've brought up my nephew. He just recently became a YouTuber himself. He started up his own YouTube channel. He's under the name Starboy72. So if you would like to, and for him, and well, for me as well, because I'm his uncle, go check him out. Check out his videos. Subscribe to him. Follow him. Like his videos. He's new to it, so he hasn't really gotten a full itinerary of specifically what he's gonna do. It's kind of just like random things, basically, but still, go check him out. Subscribe to him, like his videos, comment on them if you want, and I'm sure he'll get a kick out of it.
Yeah, for sure. Subscribe to him. You know, I remember when I first started 11 years ago, and it's a damn shame I got rid of those videos.
Yeah.
But, you know, it's a great opportunity to get your stuff out there. You know, whether it be acting or just everyday life and stuff like that. So, check Starboy72 out. And, yeah, good times. Subscribe to his channel. I know I did.
Yeah.
And for me, Matt, this is Killer Kyle, and we will see you next time. Actually, thinking about doing, in the next little while, a couple ideas thrown out there, talking about we should be in the Hall of Fame, WWE, whether it be this year, whether it be next year, future.
Yeah.
So, I think we'll do that in the future. Who knows? But I have a bunch of ideas. I know that we've done a few videos besides going through wrestling shows and stuff. So, yeah, it should be interesting. Yep. So, I'll talk to you later. Bye.
Bye.